This is Michael Tellinger's full presentation from October 30th, 2016.
It gives me great pleasure to share with you this presentation, which takes me back to the ancient civilizations, the stone circles, the sound, the resonance, the nature of reality, the ancient religions, energy, free energy, sound frequency, and then also newly added to this is magnetism and some of the new research that is reaching me, something that has to be addressed, and that is the flat earth theory that has been making a lot of waves around the world. And I look forward to touching upon that at the end of this presentation. So we're talking about free energy, breakthrough technology, ancient advanced technology, civilizations that left behind technology that we don't even understand today, but recognize as technology from the effects that we have witnessed that happen around these ancient devices and ancient ruins. So in this presentation, we will cover the following. Okay, now my computer is hanging. There we go. So these are the topics we're going to follow. What do we really know? We're going to talk about some holy cows. We're going to cover sound and energy, ancient knowledge, technology, energy, magnetism, and electricity, how that all works together with sound. We're going to touch upon the subject of free electricity and how this is somehow eluding us all the time while it is right in front of our eyes. We're going to talk about our reality, our perceived reality, and the nature of reality that we find ourselves in. And then we're going to discuss the Earth, ball or flat, and take this into an interesting discussion. And I can tell you that it is not what many people think. And then finally, stretching the boundaries of our open minds as far as we believe we can, and see how far how open our minds really are. A good friend of mine that has passed on, Andy, used to say that having an open mind is like being pregnant. You can't be half pregnant. Either you are or you're not. So I'd like to remind everybody, those that claim they have an open mind, you need to keep that mind as widely open as possible all the time, and be prepared to bring in new knowledge and new information that yesterday we may have thought was completely ridiculous and insane. So let's carry on. First thing I want to start off with, excuse me. Remember that everything we've been told is a lie. When I first heard the statement many, many years ago, I scoffed at it and I couldn't understand how anybody could make such a ridiculous statement. Today, not only do I embrace it wholeheartedly, but I'm discovering new areas of my life, of our existence, of our reality every day, and often many times a day, that we previously completely misunderstood because of the lies that we've been sold and told throughout our lives from the earliest memory. So everything we've been told about our lives, our planets, our history, science, technology, health, biology, genetics, the universe, the creation, the money system, everything we've been told is a lie. And we have to go back and open Pandora's box to discover how it all fits together and why things look so, not only look, but feel and are so confusing in this world we find ourselves today. So I'll start off with the three holy cows of our education system that I like to just fire out, three of the hotly debated topics that many people still somehow arm wrestle, and they don't realize that we've moved way beyond that point. We're not even on the same page. We're not even in the same book. We've left that book, and we're in a whole different era of research and discovery. And these holy cows are: humans evolved out of apes, nothing can travel faster than the speed of light, and energy cannot be created or destroyed. It can only be converted from one form to another. Now, that last holy cow is a very interesting one, and that comes with a bunch of considerations. So don't jump to conclusions when you read that. Don't go back into the box and say, yes, well, that's exactly what it is, because there's a lot more to that tale of energy, where it comes from, how it materializes into this reality, the energy that seems to bring forth everything in this existence, in this reality of ours, where that comes from and how that's manipulated. So let's go back over these first three. The theory of evolution is a long gone, forgotten idea. And the Darwinian theory of evolution that's been forced down our throats has been dispelled, has been shown to be completely inaccurate. And Darwin himself had an absolute zero understanding of genetics and how complicated life and matter and cells really are. His understanding of what a cell is was absolutely non-existent. So any kind of conclusions that Darwin may have reached in his ignorant observation of the world around him is far removed from how things really work at the microscopic and the atomic level. And the whole idea of natural selection has been blown out of the water by learned people and researchers many, many times and over again. However, it remains to be shoved down our throats as the model, because it is part of the agenda of the disinformation and the pulling the blinkers over our eyes. So the theory of evolution, remember, it remains a theory of evolution. It has never been actually proven to be the fact. And I'm talking about human evolution here specifically, human beings that apparently evolved out of apes or gorillas or whatever they're trying to tell us. So very sensitive subject with many people. However, go and do your own research and you realize how childish this theory is to hold on to. There is a wonderful documentary that I would like to recommend to every one of you. If you have not seen this yet, I really do recommend. It is one of the best documentaries on the education system I've seen in many years. It is called Expelled, No Intelligence Wanted, or No Intelligence Required. And it's hosted by Ben Stein in the USA. And it is a mind-opening documentary that shows you how anybody who even refers to the word creationism or creation concept is immediately expelled from their senior academic positions. And most of these people can never find a job in academia ever again. Watch it. It's a thrilling documentary. The second holy cow statement, that nothing can travel faster than the speed of light, was completely dismissed and dispelled, proven wrong in 2005 in the Middle Tennessee State University, when a bunch of undergraduates and some high school students propelled sound beyond the speed of light. And this was published in the American Institute of Physics in 2007 with all the documents, and very quickly hidden from the scientific world, because this is not what they want people and our students and our children to know, that you can propel sound beyond the speed of light. So there are some other very important considerations when we talk about sound. And when I talk about sound, I mean resonance, sound, and frequency, those that go together. And how that is affected by density and the density of matter, and how in the infinite density of what some researchers and scientists like Nassim Haramein refer to as the vacuum, in the infinite density of vacuum, sound travels and resonance travels infinitely fast. There's another clue as to how information in the morphogenetic field or the quantum field from which matter seems to materialize, why information travels instantly into all corners of existence and creation. And then finally, the last one, which can be argued from some very interesting perspectives, is that we cannot create or destroy energy. It can only be turned from one to another. And then they try and sell us the whole Big Bang theory, that everything in existence came out of this one moment, this one infinitely tiny, minuscule point called the singularity, out of which everything suddenly exploded and created this magnificent universe that we find ourselves in, with countless unimaginable galaxies and cluster galaxies and matter and stars and planets and stuff that we can't even imagine, and giant nebulae that constantly create millions and billions of new stars every second. And all of this came out of one tiny little singular moment of creation called the singularity. And then when you confront these scientists and these people that promote this theory about this, well, where did that energy come from to create all this? They say, well, that energy already existed. It was all just compressed into a tiny, tiny little space. So that energy already existed, but was always there. So that's a very interesting debate to have about the origins of the energy that's behind the creation of the universe. And we'll find, as we go through this presentation today, how our perception of this changes and how we start to see different possibilities of how these things come into existence and materializing into physical, visible, and mostly invisible and untouchable and indetectable energetic forms and fields and shapes. So this brings us back to the great human puzzle and why we are so confused and why we remain a species with amnesia, because we don't know who we are, where we come from, and why we are here. And we continue questioning our existence. And these three simple questions that all of us, probably most of us, have asked ourselves throughout our lives. And this remains, this is the main reason why we remain a species of amnesia, a species with amnesia. And this is by design, people. Understand this, that this is not by accident. This lack of knowledge and information is not because we're just stupid and dumb and we don't know. Clearly, when we look at the ancient civilizations, their knowledge, their incredible advanced knowledge of pretty much everything around us in existence is infinitely more superior to the knowledge we're taught at school and in our educational institutions today. And we keep reducing this ancient knowledge to some mumblings of idiots and stupid people from the past who didn't really know what they were talking about. Well, they knew a lot more than we know today, because we don't understand how they did what they did in the past with our most advanced technology and the education that we impose on our children and ourselves. So we have to realize that this amnesia is by design. This amnesia is growing deeper by the day because of the continuing brainwashing and disinformation that most of humanity is subjected to and actually subjects themselves to through the mainstream media, and specifically the television, with the frequencies that they broadcast at us and that they project. And so let's go back to this realization about our place in the universe, our place in this reality. And we realize, when we look at ancient civilizations, that history is much older, much stranger, much more exciting, much weirder, much everything, much more everything than most of us can imagine. It really is. And all we have to do is open our eyes. I've presented this many times in my presentations. All you got to do is, for example, look at how the evidence of giants on Earth has been removed. And if you want to watch a brilliant presentation on this, please watch Hugh Newman's presentation. It's online, on the giants and how the Smithsonian, especially for the last 150 years, has been behind very meticulously removing all evidence of giants around the world. And this is just a subject that will not be discussed, because you're discovering skeletal evidence of giants all over the world is a clear indication how little we know about our human history and how much more accurate the scriptures are that we read, ancient scriptures. And through this presentation, you'll find that suddenly, with the rise of knowledge and consciousness and the expanding of our knowledge and opening our minds, suddenly the information that we read between the lines and the scriptures of all ancient cultures and even the Bible and the more popular ancient scriptures and religious material, we suddenly realize how much critical information we find in those scriptures. And we'll get back to that. Here in South Africa, many of you will be familiar with this spectacular giant footprint, once again, showing us physical evidence. And remember, let me go back to this slide here. Each one of these giants were actually found and discovered. This is not somebody's imagination. These are real discoveries and real ancient giants that were discovered. And here's a physical evidence of this hidden history that is completely ignored and swept under the carpet by mainstream academia. If you could hear what the mainstream academia have to say about these giant footprints, it's laughable. It's like children arguing about something that they don't really understand, purely because they have very little knowledge of geology and how geology is actually formed, how the rocks and the matter on this planet are actually formed. Everything that the geologists are taught at university, most, not everything, but most of it is completely incorrect information. The other thing that gives us a clue, that gives us information how, or an indication how old these ancient sites are just by looking and studying the rocks and the erosion on the rocks in the ancient sites. I show this one, as I've shown before many times, Stonehenge, one of the most popular and famous ancient sites, is much, much older than most of us can imagine. If you look right in the middle at that stone that is lying flat, you'll see a break on that stone. And that break has erosion of about 2 feet on it. And this is just absolutely incredible. They tell us that that stone, which is Sarsen stone, a very, very hard stone, eroded 2 feet from the break in just a few thousand years. Now, it doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure out that that is absolutely impossible. So what the geology tells us is that Stonehenge is either a lot older than it is, than we've been told, or than we think, or they've placed those stones there, and they're not actually from there, and they're actually lying to us and deceiving us. At this stage, I'll believe anything, because the lies and the deceptions that you discover as you peel away the veils of deceptions and lies are so spectacular, and they get bigger and bigger as you go down the rabbit hole. And we're going to talk about that. So throughout all this discovery, throughout this all this realization and contemplation of the past, contemplating our place in the universe and everything about it, creation, there's one thing. Through all these lies and deceptions, there is one common denominator that remains the source of all things, and that is sound and resonance. No matter where you look, what ancient civilization you go to, what stories of creation you read and study, sooner or later you will hear those words or read those words that suggest that sound or resonance gave forth to everything in creation, to our planet, to everything around us. And so these remain the common links of all ancient cultures, all religious movements. Sooner or later, it is the sound of the Creator that brings everything into creation. And this is very, very important, because this is like discovering the Holy Grail of everything we've tried to understand. And the more we embrace sound and resonance, the easier it is to explain pretty much everything in our reality, and whether it's visible, physical, or invisible, or untouchable, everything can be explained and understood through our understanding of sound, resonance, and frequency. In Christianity, we have the word. In Hinduism, we have the Om. Egyptians sang the world, the universe into creation. The original people of Australia believe that the world was created with three sacred songs, and so it goes, and so it goes. So it is clear that sound remains the source of all creation. And remember, what this also then indirectly points to is that because we as human beings of higher consciousness, of flesh and blood and infinite soul, beings that contemplate our own reality, that contemplate thoughts and can verbalize our thoughts and our dreams, can manifest our thoughts into physical form. What you're thinking, you can manifest into sound, means that we can create our own reality. As we've been told more than 100 years ago in quantum physics, that we are the makers and the creators of our own reality. Excuse me. So, if you can think and imagine something, and then those thoughts are frequencies and vibrations and resonance that happens in your brain, in your thoughts that you get from somewhere, that you bring through your brain and you verbalize it and you bring it into life, you create it. This tells us that sound is a source of creation and we are co-creators of our own reality because we can verbalize our thoughts and our dreams. And for those that can go online, go and look at the Cymoscope experiments, Eric Larson's Cymoscope, and look at the incredible infinite number of shapes and patterns and forms that are created by our voice. It is truly magnificent. It is an infinite number of creations that we are capable of creating through speech alone. So this brings us to the fact that we realize that sound is the breath of the Creator. It is the prime resonance frequency that brings everything into creation. And through this, I often teach that our body is a fantastic example how only out of unity can you attain infinite diversity. Only out of the unified source, prime resonance frequency, prime source of this creative source of frequency, God or the Creator, call it whatever you want. How out of this we can create infinite diversity, but it has to remain coherent harmonic resonance, because the moment it goes into dissonance and it starts to clash with the other resonant harmonics, it goes into dis-ease, and that's where you start getting sick and diseased. Think about our body. Our bodies consist of trillions of cells that all come from the first primordial cell out of which we are born. The first egg that starts to divide and creates multiples of cells that grow and grow. And eventually those cells start to form different kinds of cells and become specialized cells like the liver cell or the skin cell or the heart cells, and create clusters of cells that are different, and yet they work together in perfect harmony for the greatest benefit of the whole community of cells in your body. This is a perfect example how only out of unity can you get infinite diversity and create infinite creation out of this primordial source. And this prime resonance frequency is really important, because we keep coming back to this. In Star Trek, we hear all the time about the prime directive, and somehow the prime directive was something that you cannot breach. You cannot breach the prime directive. Well, what is the prime directive that Star Trek keeps talking about? I believe it is the breath of God, this prime resonance frequency of the Creator, of everything in creation. Because the moment you go against that, the moment you create dissonance, the moment you start to go against that primary source of creation, you're in dis-ease, you're in dissonance with the creation. And immediately you'll start to destroy yourself and destroy everything in your physical form and probably non-physical form too. So I believe that the Star Trek message is, don't go against the laws of nature. Don't go against the creative force. You cannot breach the prime directive. And the consequence of breaching the prime directive is you will destroy yourself. The moment you go against that very powerful source code, it will destroy you. You will get sick and you will die. And this is what I believe is happening in the world today. Those conscious people that are working together, working to find solutions for our planet, working to find solutions for our social structure, like the Ubuntu movement and other brilliant movements out there that are doing incredible work in uniting people, sharing knowledge and information, but providing a new way out without conflict, without violence, without resistance, without fighting anyone or opposing anyone, just creating a new alternative, a new reality. This is critical. So we do not create dis-ease or dissonance. We remain in harmonic resonance with everything in creation, but we utilize the tools that have enslaved us to actually liberate us from this mental, physical, and spiritual enslavement that we've been trapped in for so long. So it's very important to recognize this and understand that we do not want to breach the prime directive. We want to now start working. There's been enough violence and death and destruction for so many millennia. Now we're reaching a stage in our human consciousness where we realize those are not solutions. We're not going to solve any problems like that. So for those people that have been following my work with the Ubuntu movement, this is very important. The problems, the solutions to our problems are going to be solved by creating a new alternative without no conflict or resistance or violence. And once that new alternative has been created, everyone will simply follow it. And the old system and the old way will simply die away and disappear. So very important to realize this, that sound is a precursor to the electromagnetic universe. Sound starts the resonance, rumbles, everything comes into creation. And out of that sound are generated magnetic fields. And those magnetic fields then give rise to the electromagnetic universe. So there's a beautiful natural order of things and a sequence of events that we'll talk about later. So many people talk about the electromagnetic universe and the galaxies and all this, how it all works together. And also for the brilliant work of David Talbot and his colleagues that work on the electric universe, showing very clearly that our universe is not filled with nuclear explosions and stars are a nuclear explosion exploding, you know, nuclear reactors, which is also absolute lies and nonsense. That the stars are actually electric phenomena, electromagnetic phenomena, and nothing to do with nuclear fission or fusion and nuclear furnaces. And even the electromagnetic universe has to, and the electric universe will look at how that comes into reality through the sound and the magnetic effects that sound creates. So sound inspires religious symbols. What's really important, what I mentioned right up front before we started, the ancient, when I was looking actually at Neil's logo, the logo of Portal of Ascension, if you look at that logo, you'll see another beautiful circle with these incredible images in it. And those images are sacred geometric images that are connected to the torus shape, the magnetic fields that come out of sound and resonance, and the sacred geometry that comes out of those fields and those shapes out of the sound. The sacred geometry that comes out of sound and magnetism. Now, ancient religious movements or ancient civilizations and the religious groups, the Christians and all those that go back from Islam, Christianity, Judaism, all use these symbols extensively in ancient times. Their floors are covered with these sacred geometry symbols that come from sound resonance, from cymatics and magneticism, magnetic field shapes. So the floors are covered with it, the walls are covered with it, the ceilings are covered with it. The doorways take on the shapes of some of these magnetic field shapes and structures and the cymatic pattern structures, shapes, should I say. And you realize that these people have known about this for thousands of years. They've known this and they've captured it in images in their secret societies because you know who these people were. These are all part of the secret societies that have been manipulating humanity for so long. So they've known all about this. They hide it in plain sight in their murals, in the walls, the same in their artwork, the same way that modern Hollywood hides this knowledge and information in plain sight in the movies they make and they shove down our throats. That they choose the blockbusters, busting the block of our unconsciousness. They choose those blockbuster movies. They fill them with encoded subliminal messages and information. and they present it to the world, to the people, who ignorantly absorb this, digest it, and they don't realize that they've been given knowledge and information about the enslavement and the state of our reality here. What is really going on? What is this planet of ours? What is this earth? Where does it come from? Where do we come from on this earth? How does it all work together? And you'll find that this, the answers to this are getting more and more mysterious and more fascinating. And this is way beyond just, you know, the many ET discussions and channelings and ET contacts and ET abductions and all that kind of information that has been shared over millennia. This is a whole nother expose that is happening here. So cymatics and sound inspires religious symbols, right? Remember, sound isn't just a wave, and resonance isn't just a wave on a whiteboard. It's a three-dimensional effect that happens and goes in all directions. And or it can be channeled. It can be focused in one direction, but generally it moves out in this reality. It moves out in all directions, like this image here. Three-dimensional sound bubble. But when you drill into some of these cymatic three-dimensional sound bubbles, this is what you find, this perfect cross in a circle. Sound, the source of matter, the source of reality, of our reality. And this is what the ancient religious movements knew. They understood the sound was a source of everything and our reality here. And they encoded it, once again, hidden in plain sight. Hide the cross in a circle, in your logos, in your symbols, shoving it in our faces. Let's go through what sound and resonance actually do, just a quick list, and then we'll go through some of them. First of all, by now you should all know that sound levitates. In ancient times, in modern times, we're showing it more and more. Scientists all over the world are doing this in their labs now. But I must tell you that the way they're levitating with sound today is a deception, because this is not how they used to levitate with sound in ancient times. And the reason they're releasing this sound levitation to the world, and you can get videos of it everywhere, is because you'll never be able to use this technique to levitate very heavy stones. 1,000-ton, you know, granite block, or Edlid Skalnin could not have done this. With his giant blocks at Coral Castle, some of which I believe weighed up to 90 tons. He could not have done this with this kind of sound levitation. This is a very different way that they use in ancient times. Sound boils water. Sound creates light. Sound creates DNA. Sound heals and destroys pathogens. As we mentioned already, sound moves beyond the speed of light. And then we discover this thing called hypersound, and SASER technology, as opposed to laser technology. Sound can make things invisible. Sound energizes the water that we drink, without which that water would be dead. And sound energizes the air that we breathe, without which energy, the air that we breathe would not sustain us, and we would suffocate and die. And as we said before, sound is a precursor to electromagnetism and to the electromagnetic universe. Ancient civilizations knew all of this, and they understood sound and frequency, and they used it as a source of energy and a tool in ways that we are now really starting to understand in much greater detail. Sound and frequency was used to control and manipulate humanity for thousands of years. This is not something new. Remember, the ancients didn't waste their time on insignificant carvings and depictions. They carved significant things because they were hiding the information in plain sight, showing what they're doing to the people in ancient times, and we're still seeing those depictions today. So we clearly understand now that the pineal gland is a frequency receptor in the middle of our brain. It's like our third eye. It contains the same internal organs, the rods and cones, and many other internal structures that is virtually identical to the eye except the lens. And it is basically a frequency receiver and a frequency transmitter that has been manipulated, that we can no longer use to give us ESP or allow us to communicate with ESP. However, on that note, what I thought of the other day is many people that claim to have had contact with ETs and abducted and whatever, they always say that they communicate with the ETs telepathically. So that made me realize that if these people can communicate with the ETs telepathically, we should be able to communicate with each other telepathically. Surely that's, you know, it's not a one-sided argument. It's got to go both ways. So maybe there's a lot more to this pineal gland that than we realize, and maybe we can actually use our pineal gland, but we just forgotten how to do it, or we don't have the right frequencies. We can't generate the right frequencies with our thoughts and with our minds. Maybe our consciousness has been suppressed so low that we cannot generate those high frequencies to activate our pineal gland. And some of these people that claim to have had contact and communication with ETs that communicate with them telepathically, maybe it's the ETs that are actually projecting the frequency into those people to activate their pineal gland. So for that moment, they can communicate with them. And when they go, that ability just disappears again. Who knows? That's just an idea that I'm throwing out at you. But it's obvious that the ancient, these beings, these winged beings and bird-headed winged beings clearly were doing things to humanity. And they used cone-shaped tools. Very obviously, the cone-shaped tools that they did something to people, manipulating us and controlling our pineal gland, I believe, and also our DNA or the tree of life with sound and with frequency. And this control has not just been happening over thousands of years ago, but it happens today. It continues today through our TV, radio, cell phones, and especially Wi-Fi. And it's, you know, I'm talking to you on Wi-Fi and I don't know what's going on, what the Wi-Fi is doing to my brain and how it's frying my brain, but we guess that it is doing some serious damage to us, and yet we continue using it because that's what we've been given to use. I believe that we can use our consciousness to override this. I believe that you internally can create the energy fields, and if you manifest it with your thoughts and you say it, we can generate those energy fields to neutralize the negative effects of all this electro smog, all these frequencies that have been designed to manipulate us, to control our minds. It starts within us. Remember, we are the creators of our own reality, and therefore we should be able to neutralize these frequencies that are used to control us as well. What's important to note those six cone shapes on the NBC logo pointing to the middle. And it seems that I'll come back to those cone shapes that are there just in a little while. Sound, let's talk about sound as a tool and technology. Clearly, the Egyptians used the ankh, which is a sound resonating device. The ankh was used for healing, and we know from people that have done extensive research into Egyptology that the Egyptians were regrowing organs, they were regrowing limbs, they were doing incredible things in Egypt in their sound healing chambers that have been destroyed. Only, you know, parts of them remain, and they're very difficult to put together for those that haven't really got the knowledge and information about this, so who haven't been to those sites and actually witnessed it. So from those that have done a lot of research into it, they tell us that the Egyptians used sound in the healing chambers to do incredible things. In the Native American culture, they show us the medicine wheel as a symbol for healing and curing diseases. Clearly, once again, going back to the source of creation, recognizing that sound is a source of all things, and with sound, you can heal and cure everything imaginable. Royal Raymond Rife, as most of you should know by now, and already was called the man who found a cure for all disease, with his universal telescope that could see living viruses and living bacteria, which the electron microscope cannot do, not even today. And he could actually manipulate and see what happens to these bacteria when exposed to different frequencies and find its prime resonant frequency, which destroys the bacteria, or frequencies that create a dissonant frequency that then destroys the pathogen, whether it's a bacterium or a virus. And and I saw his book, which is in a library in Sedona, Arizona, and this is his handwritten book in which he actually writes down the frequencies and the cures for many of the diseases that he treated. His life is really a wonderful example how we truly can cure all disease with sound and resonance, sound frequency. But he's not the only guy that has done it. He's the first, the most famous person, I guess, in recent times that has done it. But very recently, these are just more of his handwritten notes. this one talks about tuberculosis and how to cure tuberculosis and what the frequencies are. Very recently, the same, exactly the same incredible results were found and demonstrated by this guy here, Anthony Holland. Anthony Holland, who did an incredible TED talk, and I recommend you go and look at his TED talk in 2011, I believe it was, where he shows how he found the frequencies, and he tells us those frequencies are between 100,000 and 300,000 hertz, and those frequencies basically kill cancer cells. And he shows you on video that they captured when those frequencies, when those cancer cells, all kinds of cancer cells that were exposed to his specific frequencies, and how those cancer cells simply disintegrate and are destroyed without destroying any of the living tissue or other little microscopic organisms that are swimming around in your body and in your body, I guess, around the cancer cells, how everything remains completely unaffected, and yet the cancer cell is destroyed. So all to do with sound and resonance and frequency. And obviously the Ark of the Covenant is a great example of ancient advanced technology in gold and in communication, and where the mercy seat on top of the Ark of the Covenant, when God says to Moses or to Aaron, put the mercy seat, Moses, I think, put the mercy seat between the cherubim and sit on the mercy seat, and I will talk to you from there and tell you what to tell the Israelites. So clearly we're dealing with a communication device of some sort. And also remember that the Ark of the Covenant brought down the walls of Jericho with a blast of a trumpet and a shout. The walls came tumbling down. So we're dealing with some resonance. They walked with the ark around the walls for several days, putting out some sort of low subsonic frequency that destabilized the stones, and then put out some sort of electromagnetic pulse, just like in Ocean's 11, that put out all the lights in Las Vegas. Same kind of thing. With a blast of a trumpet and a shout, the walls came tumbling down. All to do with sound and resonance, and the Ark of the Covenant was clearly such a device that did something like that. Here are some of the more recent levitation experiments that have been done, levitating things between two sound sources in a laboratory. You can go online and look at many, many videos that have been loaded recently about sound that levitates. And then we go back to 1888 and John Keeley, who truly was one of those incredible people that even predates Nikola Tesla. And the incredible things John Keeley was doing with sound, also levitating, drilling precision holes into very hard rock, pulverizing rock into the finest dust powder within minutes, where today we struggle to do that with very basic, ridiculous mechanical technology, with rolling metal balls and in steel drums to get the rock in the mines, for example, to break down the rocks of iron, the rocks that contain the gold or the platinum, to break it down into a fine powder that they can extract these materials from. John Keeley was doing this within minutes with sound and resonance in 1888 already. Peter Davey from New Zealand was boiling water with sound. You can watch his videos as well. I don't want to spend too much time on this, because those that have watched older presentations of mine will know this. It has been speaking about this for many years now. And remember that sound creates light. God said, let there be light. It's the sound of the Creator that creates the electromagnetic fields that bring forth light. And light is an effect of the electromagnetic spectrum. So, very, very simply. And remember, this brings us to sonoluminescence, something that just recently has been really spoken about, and more experiments are done with this, where you take a round spherical ball filled with water, like this one here, and you expose it to a certain frequency. And what happens in the middle, it's known as star in a jar. It's called sonoluminescence. And that sound frequency creates a very bright light to come out of the center of that water ball. And there is a close picture of that, and it's called a star in a jar. And the descriptions that you hear from some of the academics about this are completely inaccurate. They keep talking about fusion and fission and nuclear reactions and stuff like that. It's all to do with sound and resonance and magnetic effects. And here's a great example. This is a photograph of an electron with a light beam going through an electron, that line going from left to right, that dark horizontal line through the middle. Well, what can you see? You can't see an electron. What you can see are some waves. You're seeing like waves in a puddle when you throw a stone in a pond. The waves that are moving away from the center, that's what you see. And you realize that an electron is not a physical object. It is just a manifestation of coherent resonance that keeps moving around. And this is why they can't pin the electrons down, and they find it so difficult to actually prove the existence of these elusive things like electrons and all these other subatomic particles. And this is a very clear indication that an electron is just a manifestation of sound and resonance, coherent resonance, with those beautiful waves emanating from the core of the electron. Magnetrons use sound and resonance to create incredibly powerful energy that is used and channeled into laser beams, used in microwaves, in laser technology, and magnetrons are used to create laser beams that can cut metal in a split second. So through a tiny little magnetron that is probably this size, you can create enough energy in a laser beam that can cut through metal in a split second, just to show you how powerfully sound and resonance can be channeled if it's focused. It's very important. And remember that that is turned into light. So light, this is a laser beam, and the same can be done with sound, as propelling sound into a cohesive, coherent beam, which, and that's where SASER technology comes in, as opposed to laser technology, to project a sound beam rather than a light beam. And in August 2014, we were told how sound acts as a cloak of invisibility. Once again, sound can do everything. And a plastic pyramid that, when exposed to certain sound frequencies, makes things invisible when you put it underneath the pyramid. And this made me realize that this is possibly why some of the architecture in ancient cultures was built in this kind of structure. Because what do monks do when they're inside a monastery? They chant, they make specific sounds. And is it possible that they can actually make that entire monastery just like that, or that building, just like this pyramid making things invisible? If they can make themselves and everything inside invisible, or even the whole monastery goes invisible, who knows? But clearly, these people and these architects didn't build this because they were bored, and they were just, you know, this was form over function. This is very much function before form, that the form follows the function, like in all designs, right? And then, very importantly, some of the most breakthrough research that I've done is the fact that sound is actually the cause, or the thing that energizes the air that we breathe. And the fact that the air that you breathe through your trachea, through the bronchi, the alveoli, when the sound goes into your bronchus, when you breathe it in, when the air goes in, it makes a very distinct sound. If you put your hand to your ear like this and you just breathe, you can hear how loud your breathing is. But we just don't hear it because our ears are built not to pick up our breathing too loudly. Otherwise, we'd go crazy. So what happens is, as you breathe in, the air moves into your lungs. And because it keeps going into smaller and smaller orifices and passages, the air keeps speeding up and speeding up. And so does the sound frequency that comes with the air. The sound the air makes keeps speeding up and speeding up. So that by the time the air that you breathe reaches your lungs, the alveoli, that are wrapped around by the arteries in your lungs, the sound is probably traveling faster than the speed of light. It's moving at hypersound speeds and generating energy that's generated by sound in a hypersound state. And hypersound generates insane amounts of energy. This is something that we can discuss in other lectures at another time, where I'll bring some of these experts in hypersound, and they're really two experts in the world that I've become friendly with, both in Europe. One is in Croatia and one is in Germany. And these guys will tell us an incredible amount about what hypersound actually is and what it does and how it functions in our reality. A subject that is not known about by, or only known about by a few researchers in the world. So by the time the sound reaches and the air reaches our alveoli, it is energizing the air that we breathe. The oxygen in the air is energized by the sound that the air makes. And it is that energized oxygen that is then extracted from the lungs and goes into the blood. And it's the energy attached to that oxygen that is then used in our blood. And when that energy has been, the oxygen has been stripped of its energy, the oxygen gets expelled in the form of carbon dioxide or carbon monoxide. All depends how toxic you are. And that's it. And then you start the process again. That's why we breathe. And that's what I believe, incidentally, how the Sam Osmanagic's Bosnian pyramid functions and what is actually the driving force that gives the pyramid the energy. And if you don't know this yet, Sam Osmanagic has measured very, very powerful energy beam that emanates from the top of the Bosnian pyramid that shoots up out of the pyramid. Very strong electromagnetic field and sound frequencies that they've detected there. And then when I was in the underground tunnels with Sam, I realized that these tunnels that they've been excavating, and they've excavated, I think, close to 2 kilometers of these underground tunnels that seem to have been filled by something or someone with this loose material, sand and pebbles, like river sand and pebbles that have filled these tunnels. When you remove this loose fill from the Bosnian pyramid, you suddenly realize that these tunnels are like these waving and moving arteries of the alveoli, the bronchi of our lungs that lead up to the pyramid, Bosnian pyramid. And there's always airflow moving through these underground tunnels. There's the cleanest and freshest air imaginable. In fact, they've actually scientifically recorded, that the air that flows through those underground tunnels has a very distinct healing property on the people that work there. Many of the volunteers that have come to work with Sam Osmanagic in the Bosnian pyramid have described how sometimes they've had back problems for many years, and suddenly their back problem has been solved or healed, or knee problems. And suddenly they can push wheelbarrows and work in these tunnels without experiencing pain in the knee and those kind of problems that they've had. So this is a very interesting discovery. The fact that we can connect the movement of the air through our lungs that energizes the oxygen that keeps us alive to the movement of the air passages, the tunnels, tunnel passages in the Bosnian pyramid, under the Bosnian pyramid, that lead up to the pyramid, that seem to resonate. The resonance of the sound, the air, and the sound of the air moving through those thousands of underground tunnels, because they just uncovered a fraction of it. Thousands of those underground tunnels that lead up to the pyramid, that is probably the source of energy for that Bosnian pyramid. There's a lot more about that. And then obviously one of the most important discoveries in recent times was Dr. Luc Montagnier in 2011 that spontaneously generated DNA in a laboratory in a test tube. And that is just unimaginable, because when you can generate a DNA from exposing another DNA molecule here, and you're passing sound through it that then reaches this empty test tube, and DNA manifests in this test tube out of nothing. Clearly, this gives us a very clear indication that the sound frequencies that carry the information from this DNA deposited in this test tube here, and means we can manifest anything we can imagine. If we can manifest DNA and create DNA with sound, keep in mind what DNA is, how much knowledge and information is encoded in that DNA strand. So not only are you picking up the shape of the DNA, but all the trillions and trillions of bits of information, the sub-frequencies and the sub-harmonics and the sub-sub-sub-sub-sub-harmonics of this DNA molecule that is encoded in it. This is what you transfer with the sound frequencies to manifest DNA out of nothing. This is quite spectacular. Just let your mind expand a bit and imagine what we have just created by generating DNA out of nothing with sound. So obviously this makes us realize that if we're looking for a source of free energy, sound is the primordial source of all energy. Everything in existence comes out of sound, and therefore everything in existence is driven by the source code, the primary prime resonance frequency, and in there lie the answers of free energy, and that's where we should be looking. If we're going to find free energy to give us, to take us into the new era, to take us into a new social structure, it is sound that we need to look at. It is the absolute source of free energy. And remember, Nikola Tesla told us this. He told us that the earth rings like a bell, and it is this ringing like a bell that never stops that gives us this form and source of unlimited energy, and utilized it and did some very interesting things with it. And because of his claim that the earth rings like a bell, it never stops ringing. And from there, we can get our uninterrupted, eternal source of energy. All we need to know is how to convert the sound energy into the form of energy that we use today, and that is electrical energy. So remember, now that we know this and we realize this, we realize that it's the sound of the earth that creates the magnetic fields, and not the so-called molten inner core that creates the magnetic fields. This is another lie and deception that we've been told. And so it's the sound of Mother Earth that creates the magnetic fields around the earth. And these are very important, remember, because when we get to the last part and we start to contemplate the shape of the earth, all of this plays an important role in some of the things that have been hidden from us and suddenly become very obvious. So there is, you know, there's not even any evidence that there's a molten core of iron in the middle of our planet. It's another theory that has just been sold as a fact. So, and very important to remember that molten metal and molten iron cannot have a magnetic field, cannot be magnetic. Only solid metals can be magnetic. So it is the sound of the earth that keeps ringing like a bell that creates the magnetic fields. And remember, the magnetic field of the earth, it comes out of the southern pole, out of the southern pole, and curves around and goes in at the north pole. Right? More important considerations to keep in mind for later. So this is not true. And then this takes us to the whole torus shape. It's unquestionable that our reality around us is made up of these infinite number of tiny toruses. Toruses, torus-shaped energy fields that seem to be responsible for everything in our reality, from the subatomic to the largest. And it's, I believe, this torus shape that is used as part of the deception, because the torus shape is often used as the shape around our world, but that's not necessarily the case, because there are other things at play here that can be argued for a different shape of the planet. So the torus shape is important, and especially the double torus shape, the double toroid effect, because one torus a single torus like this, like the torus around the Earth, for example, the shape of the Earth, the energy goes into the top and comes out of the bottom, comes out of the south and goes around and goes into the top. It is this double toroid shape that seems to create the energies that go both in from the top and the south, goes inwards. And then where the two toruses meet at the equatorial plane, that's where we see an expulsion at the equatorial plane, an expulsion of energy and matter, just like we see at the photographs of our solar system and the images of our the galaxy, the Milky Way, and other galaxies that we have photographed through the Hubble telescope. All that remains a huge question now, however, how accurate and true all that stuff is. However, the toruses and the shape of the toruses is clearly a magnetic effect. Here is the torus electron model showing you how the electron actually manifests the energy from the center core there, where the energy goes into the center, and this is how we get manifestation. This is scalar, how we've actually trapped scalar waves from our torus-shaped stone, which I'll talk about later, exactly in this fashion. So what this actually shows us is that the equator, if you look between those two toruses, that's where the matter gets expelled at the equator, the energy, that then the sound and the energy that then materializes into matter. That torus emits energy in a disk. And that's really important. Just look at that and remember this for later. That disk in the middle of the torus shape, which creates a plane of matter, energy and matter in a disk form. So recap, sound and resonance are the source of everything. Sound and resonance manifest matter, and everything in creation, seen or unseen around us, everything in creation has its own prime resonance frequency at which it exists. And this is how we can manipulate matter through prime resonance frequency. And this prime resonance frequency, the sound, generates a magnetic field or magnetic fields. And then these moving magnetic fields create electricity. So it's a very simple chain reaction that happens here, from sound to magnetics to electricity. And suddenly we have a very simple grasp of everything in creation, our entire universe that we've seen before. Now we understand a lot. It's a lot easier to explain pretty much anything or any problem that we are faced with in a physical science world. And magnetic fields, strangely enough, also create torus shapes. It's the magnetic fields and the sound that generate the magnetic fields that create torus shapes. It's impossible for it not to do. It's spectacular to see these beautiful examples. These are iron filings around magnets, very clearly creating torus shapes. And here, if you look very carefully, if you look at this, and you see the filings further away from the poles, the magnetic poles, they almost create a 3D effect in the magnetic filings around these magnetic poles. It's spectacular. And then I made a very interesting discovery. Not only do we have sound that creates torus shapes that manifests matter and magnets that create torus shapes that gives us a clear understanding between the connection between sound and magnetism, but under those special filters that show us the magnetic field, when you take specific ring magnets and circular magnets, guess what shape those magnetic fields take on? Very distinct cone-shaped magnetic fields, cone shapes. And this just blows my mind, because this comes back to my research in the ancient civilizations, in the stone circles, the tools and the artifacts I've been collecting, cone-shaped tools throughout all of history, and remind us of this ancient bird-headed beings with a cone-shaped tool in his hand and some sort of magnetic device on its wrist with these cones pointing towards the middle, just like these magnets, magnetic fields show us here. And we're starting to get a much clearer indication of what kind of tools and technology these ancient civilizations and these ancient beings used. Cone-shaped tools and magnetism played a very important role. Sound, magnetism. Remember that magnets create sound. You can go onto YouTube and check this out for yourself. When you take a magnet and you bring a special recording device to it, you hear the sound of the magnet. Well, obvious. Think about it. All of us use magnets to create sound all the time in speakers, right? It's very obvious, but we forget about it. We don't think about it. Magnets give off sound, and magnets are used to convert the impulses, the electronic, the sound frequencies that are picked up, converted into an electronic signal, come down a wire, created back into a sound, into a resonant frequency that can goes to the magnet and gives us this sound that is created on the one side and comes out on the other side. And all this with magnets. So sound and magnetism cannot be separated. It is impossible. And then those two, remember, give rise to electricity. And that's the form of energy that has been chosen for us to use. We did not choose electricity. It was chosen for us by the elite in the late 1800s. When they started experimenting with direct current and alternating current electric forms, because they could use that and put it into a grid system so they could control the supply of this electricity. It is one form of energy. There are many forms of energy. Electricity is just one form of energy which can be controlled, manipulated, and most importantly, metered, so they can put us under in an energy grid and control humanity. So let's look at the ancient tools and artifacts and see how this all connects to what we've gone through here. And I've already mentioned the cone-shaped tools. Those of you that have been following my research here in South Africa and around the world, you find cone-shaped tools all over the world. You cannot escape it. And I'm not going to bore you with it. From Egypt to England to Turkey to Australia, this is from Australia, to the Sumerian cone-shaped tools, to the Native American cone-shaped tools, to the Mayas, the Incas. Everywhere you go, you find cone-shaped tools in ancient civilizations. Ed Leeds Cullinan was reportedly using cone-shaped tools to levitate these giant coral blocks, some of which weigh up to 90 tons, apparently. I have not confirmed that, but this is what I've been told. So I do need to confirm that. If anybody confirms it, drop me a line, because I probably don't have time to go and confirm it. I'll forget about it after this presentation. So Ed Leeds Cullinan's Coral Castle is a marvel of brilliance, is example of brilliance in modern times. It's impossible to do something like this single-handedly, to cut these blocks, to put them into place. You don't do this single-handedly. You really need some seriously advanced tools to be able to do this. And that brings us to the sacred torus stones. Thousands and thousands of these torus stones lie scattered throughout Southern Africa. I've just gone hunting for some more torus stones for my museum. And incidentally, I'll be putting out a communication and sharing the exciting information for those that follow my work in ancient civilizations and the research in that area, and not just in the Ubuntu movement. I'm building a new stone circle museum. Yesterday, or the day before rather, we finished throwing the foundations and the slab for the floor. And it's a beautiful stone circle museum that will become a world-class museum. So I'm building that so that we can put all these amazing artifacts and tools into a museum and a building that really deserves to hold and display this kind of ancient knowledge and priceless artifacts. So I'll be sharing more about that very soon in the weeks to come. So these torus stones, thousands of those, and I've just started hunting for some more, and I think I've managed to get about four or five more of these stones that'll be going into the museum, and also for some research purposes, incidentally. And I'll talk to you more about what we discovered with these stones. Very early, we discovered that these stones had very, very strong energetic properties. With dowsing, anyone that does dowsing and understands how powerful a tool, a simple tool like dowsing can be, You will not believe the energy that comes out of these stones. Dowsers actually go crazy when they measure the energy that comes out of these stones. It is unimaginable. And this is what we started finding with simple techniques like that, realizing how much energy these stones emit. And I realized very quickly that these stones, after putting two and two together, that these stones are really toroid vortex field generators, energy generators. Don't let the vortex confuse you. But they're really toroid energy generators. And they emit incredible amounts of energy. We have measured, a German scientist measured the energy coming out of these torus stones by simply, they absorb, they suck in the energy, the ambient sound, they suck in the sound. This is all sound frequencies. Remember, these stones emit sound energy, sound and resonance frequencies. Not only frequencies in the radio wave, but also sound frequencies in the gigahertz, and up to 3,400 decibels of sound that this little stone emits in my museum as it sits there. It is spectacular. And this is why some of the other stones and some of the precious tools and artifacts that I've collected have actually cracked and broken from being too close to these stones. Over a period of 1 year, I had a very special stone that's known as the Klagstorp spheres, and this is where I'm going to talk briefly about those. One of my little Klagstorp spheres, or the wonder stones, that are very mysterious origins. Nobody seems to know what they are, where they come from, but they come from the mines near Klagstorp in South Africa, and they are very, very perfect shapes. And I completely forgot to put a picture of the Klagstorp sphere in here, but I was given one for my museum. And after putting it on display in the museum, I left it on display. And after about 6 months, I came in one morning and this crack appeared in this beautiful stone, perfectly spherical stone. Some of the stones have these very precise patterns, like a cricket ball or a baseball around the equator of the stone. And it's absolutely perfect. And the thing is that the stones are unquestionably man-made. They're not natural phenomena. They're made by some intelligent design or intelligent beings. And this is the big argument, obviously, where they come from, because they go back all the way to up to 3 billion years old, some of these stones are, right? These Klagstorp spheres or wonder stones. So I put my Klagstorp sphere wonder stone on display, and 6 months later it develops a crack. And I freaked out. I said, what have I done? I've broken the stone. Obviously, suddenly it's my fault. You know, the stone is, you know, a billion years old, and I put it in my museum. Within 6 months, it's broken. It's an African problem. We just keep breaking things here. I started to freak out. So I didn't know what to do. So I just left it. A few days later, the whole stone broke in half, completely split in two, and lay like this. And then slowly but surely over the next few weeks, it kept breaking into smaller and smaller pieces. And at this stage, it is still lying on display in about 10 different pieces, 10 small pieces. Something that survived a billion years, I bring it into my museum, and within a year, it breaks up into a number of fragments. Only after that, I realized that I put that wonder stone about 2 meters or 6 feet away from one of these torus stones. Now, when I asked Credo Mutwa many years ago what these wonder stones were for, he told me that they were ancient sources of light. When he first told me this, I sort of, you know, scoffed at this and thought the old man was losing his mind. And he said very distinctly that these were ancient sources of light and they were exposed to certain frequencies and suddenly they emit very bright light. And I just sort of, you know, took it into file 13, didn't think of much of it. And then I realized that if you look at a light bulb, and someone that's never seen a light bulb, and you say, look, if you put a certain frequency through that light bulb, because that's what electricity is, put a certain frequency through that light bulb, it's going to glow this beautiful, bright light. If you've never seen a light do this, you're not going to believe me. Well, the same goes for these Klagstorp spheres. If you've never seen a bland stone, circular stone, suddenly come to light and give off brilliant light, you won't believe it. Just like you won't believe me if you've never heard of sonoluminescence, the star in a jar that is sound frequency put through a spherical ball of water will create a very bright bubble of light in the center of that sphere of water. If you've never seen that, you'll never believe it. That sound can do that. So suddenly I realized that it was probably the Torah stone 2 meters away from my Klerksdorp sphere that broke that very delicate stone, which is obviously sensitive to frequencies so that it gives off light at certain frequencies. So this is just a spectacular scenario, and I would like to repeat this experiment, which will be spectacular, with another Klerksdorp sphere. So for that, I need to go and beg for a Klerksdorp sphere from my friend Professor John Hund at Pretoria University, who's got a large collection of these spheres, and we will try and replicate this when I get back one of my Torah stones from the United States. So we've also photographed, as you can see here, spiraling bubbles going into the center of the Torah stone. So clearly, even sound bubbles, and I haven't really thought about this much, but it is the sound bubbles were moving around spirals and going into the center of the stone. We've only managed to do this once, but once is enough to know that it's possible. So we need to try and recreate this again. But remember, all of this costs time, money, equipment, of which we have very, very little right now. So many of these experiments actually happen by accident. And it's just my ability to try and to put the events into context that has allowed me to figure out what's going on here. And for that, you need, a broad base of information to be able to reach conclusions that otherwise you would just look at and go, oh, I don't know what's going on here. It's crazy, eh? Crazy world. So remember that this stone that you see, Nassim Haramein, I gave to Nassim in 2013, and it is this Torah stone that crashed the TSA security system at Doha International Airport. I've got great stories about that in some of my presentations. I'm not going to bore you with that. But it reminded me that it was only in 2009 that the SASER technology was introduced to the world. And we were told about a sonic boom in SASER technology and how excited the military were, because obviously it's a technology that they could use extensively. Obviously, we know that they've been using it for a long time. We know that the ancients were using SASER technology. The cone-shaped tools very clearly indicate that sound was used or was channeled into a beam. And I believe that our Torah stones, in conjunction with some of these cone-shaped tools, may have played a role, may have been used together to create a SASER beam that comes out of the front and the tip of these cone-shaped tools, probably the same way that Edlid Skalnin used two cone-shaped tools to levitate his giant stones at Coral Castle. So remember that we have rods and cones in our retina, in our eyes, and let's just go through this. Let's just be logical and analytical here, okay? Put aside the stuff they teach us at medical school, because it's all rubbish. What they teach us, in pretty much all the faculties through the education system that we go, let's just look and observe what it is that's going on here. So we are capable of creating thoughts in our brains, in our minds. A thought that comes as a frequency from outside, our brain somehow computes it, and we can think about it and speak it if we choose to. So we can speak our thoughts, manifest our thoughts into reality, because once we speak it, we create this cymatic effect that brings it into reality. So if we think about something, that frequency is already there in our brain. And our brain is connected to what? Our brain is connected to the optic nerve that comes to our eye, to the retina, and the optic nerve is connected to the rods and cones in our retina. So if we think of something, it's a frequency, it's a resonance, it's a thought that can be channeled from our brain through our optic nerve into the retina and could possibly be used in ways like we speak words. We can also manifest something with our eyes through the rods and cones in our eyes. And there's a lens that can focus those frequencies that we emit from our eyes and don't use the eyes only as incoming information, but also outgoing information, just like SASER and laser technology can be used. So I believe that we should be able to do what Superman does, as crazy as it may sound to some people, because it's all to do with sound, resonance, and the focusing and projecting the sound through cone-shaped tools, that the sound then creates magnetic fields and distorts the gravity fields. But we'll talk about gravity because that's another deception that we've been sold. And the magnetic fields that are created around the sound, sound beam. And this is how I believe that this technology was used, through sound and magnetism that allows you to levitate very, very large objects, no matter how large they are. Doesn't matter. You could move planets if you wanted to. So ultimately, this brings us to free energy. And once again, sound is at the center of this free energy. In South Africa, we have millions and millions of stone ruins. And this is one of my big discoveries, as you know, not discovering the stone ruins, but discovering the significance of the stone ruins. Stone ruins have been known about for more than 500 years, since the late 1400s, when the Portuguese first came around the Cape of Good Hope on the way to India, and they started discovering these ancient stone ruins. And then over 500 years, they've become more studied and more famous. Great Zimbabwe is one of the most important ones in Zimbabwe. And remember that Great Zimbabwe is perfectly aligned with Adam's calendar, just south of it here in South Africa, and then north of Great Zimbabwe, exactly in a straight line from Adam's calendar, Great Zimbabwe ruins, to the Great Pyramid of Giza. So there's a very important alignment there that not many people are aware of. But these millions of stone circles in South Africa that were completely misunderstood are simply cymatic patterns. They are cymatic energy-generating devices. The stones are packed along the cymatic pattern of the sound that comes out of the earth at that point. Remember, sound through a metal plate gives you perfect cymatic patterns of that specific frequency. So each one of these stone circles is just built on top of the shape of the sound that comes out of the earth. And what happens when you do that? The sound that comes out of the earth starts to resonate the stones. The stones are rich in silica, quartzite, and crystalline structure. And then the sound starts to resonate the quartz structure. The quartz structure starts to create magnetic fields, electromagnetic fields. The sound starts to move around the circle, starts to create a perpetual motion sound because it's driven from within. It never stops. That sound keeps coming from the earth. So it drives the sound, and that sound that creates the magnetic fields, electromagnetic fields, then gives rise, well, the sound gives rise to electromagnetic fields. And if we know how to use this, we've got ourselves a perpetual, never-ending, infinite supply of energy. All we need to do is convert it to the kind of energy we use today. So once again, it starts with sound that manifests in these cymatic patterns in the millions of stone circles in South Africa. And we know this because we measured the sound frequencies. We measured the sound frequencies. We measured the electromagnetic fields that these sound frequencies create in these stone circles. We measured the loudness of it in decibels. It is spectacular how much sound and energy these stone circles give off. This particular stone circle gives off around 33.5 gigahertz, over 103 decibels out of specific stones. But the combined decibels that come out of these big stone circles is actually over 30,000 decibels. This once again was measured by a German scientist, expert in hypersound, that wrote to me and said he measured the frequencies, and it is it gives us over 30,000 decibels out of the giant stone circle. That is an unimaginable amount of sound energy coming out of there. And the electromagnetic fields, they are measured in 580 megahertz in this particular circle. But they seem to be going up and down based on the strength of the sound that comes out of the Earth. So also we have these stone circles in the shape of magnetrons. Now you can imagine if a tiny magnetron that creates a little bit of a tiny magnetron that uses a resonant cavity and resonance to create this powerful energy that is used for laser technology. If a tiny magnetron can cut metal in a split second and creates that amount of energy, just imagine how much energy a giant magnetron like that stone circle next to it, that magnetron-shaped stone circle, can create. We have thousands of these magnetron-like stone circles, and each one of these magnetron stone circles generates probably, based on two magnetron scientists that gave me the same kind of feedback, one of these giant magnetrons will generate more energy than all the power plants on Earth today. This is spectacular. So clearly we have an infinite source of free energy here, but we are not using it. And this is, once again, I need to call to all the scientists and the electrical engineers and those out-of-the-box thinkers who have resources and means to come and join me here and start doing some serious research into these energetic stone circles, because that's what we're dealing with. We have an infinite source of energy right here under our eyes and under our noses, and we're doing nothing with it. They're being destroyed by our governments, by our municipalities, by the roadworks, by the thousands every year. These stone circles are being destroyed. Adam's calendar is just a spectacular example of a free energy device, because it gives off even more energy than the millions of stone circles do. And remember that all the stone circles are connected by these channels, or used to be connected in ancient times. So in essence, we're looking at a huge energy grid, all connected, sharing this energy and putting it out somewhere, or using it for something. That still remains the question. So Adam's calendar, it looks a little bit like this in its 3D reconstruction. The measurements that we took at Adam's calendar are spectacular. Inside the imaginary circle, the moment you walk in there, we pick up over 375 gigahertz of sound frequency. It is unimaginable. That is just insane amount of energy. That is high technology that very few tech companies use today. And the electromagnetic fields there that run at 1700 megahertz as a horizontal field, and 1800 megahertz higher than that, between the two calendar stones, between those two stones, the electromagnetic fields run higher, and they actually spiral out of the ground into the sky. So around the stones, the central stones, the energy runs horizontally, and between the stones, it runs vertically out of the ground into the sky. So it seems that we've got one of these, this torus interlink magnetic fields, and or something like this, that is like some sort of an active vortex or a portal, who knows for what. But what we do know is that the ancient stone structures are all made out of stones, and these stones resonate, they ring like bells, they have high crystal content. It's very difficult to find stones without crystalline content. Pretty much all stone on Earth has got crystalline, very high crystalline content, some up to 80-90% crystalline content. And quartz is pretty much, 100% crystal, so in a specific form. So we have stones that ring like bells, high crystal content. We know that silica has memory. Quartzite has memory. And conducts light and sound. We use it in our most advanced technology today, in fiber optics. We use silicon-based technology in everything we do today at the highest level. And also we know that digital data can be stored in crystals. This information was shared, great new discovery, and very quickly hidden, because the computer industry certainly didn't want the people to know that in one crystal they can store trillions of terabytes of information and they never have to buy another backup hard drive. And that information in the crystal is a lot more secure than in a backup hard drive. So clearly, these ancient stone structures that were not only energy devices using the crystalline structure in them, were doing all kinds of other things, also containing information in the crystalline structure. So I believe that these ancient structures are actually giant memory banks at the same time, probably holding all the information in the crystals inside these rocks, all the knowledge and information of all the history that's ever happened to those ancient stone structures. And not only that, we realize that because of sound being the source of energy and source of resonance, source of magnetic fields and source of everything in creation, we suddenly realize that all these ancient structures, just like the millions of stone structures in South Africa, are actually just giant machines, giant energy devices, and they're activated by either sound and sometimes even light. So the stone circles in South Africa were very obviously activated by sound because of the cymatic pattern shapes. That's a dead giveaway. I bet it took 500 years for someone like me to come around and figure it out. Isn't it amazing? 500 years of observing these stone circles and constantly saying, are they just dwellings for people or migrating tribes or dwellings or enclosures for cows? That's what it's been for 500 years. And suddenly our reality has been completely changed. And that brings with it the understanding of all the other ancient structures, because we realize that they're also giant resonators using not only sound, but sometimes even light. And the Great Pyramid is a great example of how those shafts in the Great Pyramid actually use light from the stars to activate that machine to do something. Because that's what these actually are. They're giant machines. And remember, the pyramids are still alive, just like the stone circles are still alive. And we're measuring incredible energy coming out of the stone circles. Energies have been measured coming out of the pyramids that are mind-blowing, not only with instruments, but with photographs showing us that they give off very specific energetic fields. The very symmetrical interference patterns that we find from measuring sound experiments in Stonehenge clearly shows that Stonehenge is not an accident, that was built for very specific reasons, and that it's an acoustic device using sound as its core principle to generate energy. And therefore, it is another energy device, Stonehenge. Very obvious. And you can go to all the ancient structures in India, you start looking at the ancient structures in the Incas and so forth. But where we find the most amazing breakthrough and understanding of how we've been manipulated as a species is when you start looking at some of the more esoteric information that we get. For example, the so-called crystal grid, the energetic grid around the Earth, that all these ancient structures are built upon very specific nodal points on this energetic grid, and not just thrown randomly around wherever these ancient cultures decided to build a pyramid or build that. They built it for very specific reasons on very specific energetic nodal points. And this is what we find very fascinating and very important in understanding how mysterious and how insane the history of this planet is. It is nothing like we imagine, nothing like our history books tell us. It is far removed from anyone's wildest imagination, and I think the wildest science fiction movies of our planet's history are not even close to how weird and amazing and probably torturous it was for some people, but also mind-blowing in what was really going on here. And here's a Sumerian tablet. There's its number, MS5103. And it talks about the creation of the world, and it refers to the Anunnaki, and An and Enlil and Enki, the so-called Sumerian Holy Trinity. And it says that in the distant days, those days after destinies had been decreed, after An and Enlil had set up the regulations for heaven and earth, Enki, the exalted knowing God, by the rules for heaven and earth, the fixed rules, he set up cities. So it seems to me like this clay tablet is telling us about the fixed rules, the fixed energetic grid, the fixed rules in heaven and on Earth. So there seems to be some sort of an energetic grid in the sky that they talk about, and the energetic grid that it's mirrored on the surface of the Earth. And according to that energetic grid, they put up the cities and the ancient structures on Earth. Now, for those that have watched my previous presentations and workshops, I talk about my friend Paul Cravenstein here in South Africa that has actually measured and detected on many occasions now. I had a long discussion with Paul about 2 weeks ago again, and he shared even much more information with me now about this energetic grid in the sky. He basically says it's like a matrix. It's like a computer-generated kind of code. It consists of zeros and ones, some sort of an energetic binary code barrier in the sky that he measures up, and he says it's incredibly resilient. You cannot break it. He has tried to send up frequencies, because this guy generates frequencies and does amazing things, and he's tried to send up frequencies to try and break it, and he makes a small dent in it, but it immediately recreates itself. So there's definitely an energetic grid around us up in the sky, in the heavens above, and an energetic grid on the ground below. And all these ancient structures are built on these energetic grids. And the temples in Egypt are no exception. And these are giant technology on a gigantic scale that we could not have imagined. And this was another interesting discovery that I made when I started looking at these, knowing that the stone circles in South Africa are energy devices, the pyramid is an energy device, and suddenly I started looking at the aerial shots of these temples in Egypt, only to realize that they make no sense as so-called temples where people come and worship and offer here to this god and make food offerings, and it's all absolute nonsense. Part of the deception has been going on for a long, long time, and that these temples are actually templates, and they're templates for giant energy circuits, just like we use today in our technology, except this was huge technology, silicon-based technology on a gigantic scale that we can't even imagine, because we don't have the technology to build it today. If you look at those temples in Egypt, and this one on the left here, which is from Persia, Persepolis, they make absolutely no sense whatsoever as dwellings or places of worship or temples, but they make absolute sense to those that built circuit boards. And I've had several discussions with circuit board designers and engineers, and they absolutely confirm and concur that these are ancient circuit boards on a gigantic scale. And not only circuit boards, but giant macro processors instead of micro processors like this one here. Remember, it's all to do with silica, with quartz, silicon-based technology. The quartzite that resonates sound, resonance, magnetic fields, energy generation, and the more of these ancient giant macro processors rather than micro processors connected to a circuit board next to it. And the pyramids are no exception. And just like I mentioned that this pyramid probably works with a movement of water and resonance from under the earth, the Bosnian pyramid most certainly seems to work with a movement of air and the sound the air makes through the thousands of underground tunnels that move towards the Bosnian pyramid and create the energy that has been measured coming out the top. And then it seems that it was human noise or sound of people that holds up this energy grid around the earth, because in many examples of these ancient giant circuit boards, and the Parthenon in Greece is just another ancient circuit board that has just been broken down. So remember, when you look at the Parthenon, don't think of ancient Greek. The Greeks inherited it. It was long there, long before the Greeks moved in there. The Greeks just inherited it, and it was ruined, and they didn't know what its original structure was for. And right next to it, you see those beautiful, perfectly semicircular, semi and a half circle, half sphere, half circle, perfect acoustic structure. When you put somebody on stage, you can hear the people whisper. You can hear that person even when they whisper anywhere in that auditorium. And these are how these ancient auditoriums were built. Absolute perfect acoustics, all to do with sound. And it seems like when you fill that that auditorium with people, and you either fill them with fear, or you excite them, or you have a, you know, some lions eating some Christians, or whatever the hell they were doing there, that sound energy of those people gets transmitted through these standing vibrating pillars that carry that sound, and it plugs into the circuit board on top of the mountain, and it seems that it's the sound of human beings and people that actually activated these ancient circuit boards, and somehow possibly to hold up this energetic matrix up in the sky. Who knows what it was for, but it certainly is not what we think it was. Here's another example of a, you can see the very badly broken down circuit board, and then the amphitheater right next to it, connected with a lovely long a comb of vibrating pillars that carries the energy into the circuit board. And there's another one here. There's the amphitheater on the edge of the mountain, and the very, very badly broken down and eroded circuit board on top of that mountain. And remember, this is what these pillars and the obelisks were for, either to capture the energy from the sky and put it into the circuit board, or activate the circuit board and channel that energy through the obelisks into the sky, just like we do with laser beams today and phaser beams today. So remember, this is all comes back to the fact that free energy has got everything to do with magnetics and sound. That's where we're going to find our source of free energy, not in some weird exotic things and winding things and copper and all that. It is magnetic fields, magnetic energy, and sound energy that we need to be looking at, which means a restructuring of the way that our technology works. Start moving away from electronics and electricity and start moving into magnetics. And that changes pretty much everything in our reality today. What we got to remind ourselves is that everything we've been told is a lie. The same notion with which I started this presentation. And the more we go down this rabbit hole, the more evident it becomes. Everything we've been told about Exodus from Egypt by the Hebrews is a lie. There is no physical evidence of that. That's a huge deception that many people are not even aware of. The Egyptians know nothing about the Exodus from Egypt. And the moon landing is clearly a hoax and a lie. No one walked on the moon that we know of. If you want to watch that, watch the Kubrick Odyssey. Watch Jay Widener's Kubrick Odyssey. That'll very clearly show you that all the so-called moon landing shots have been shot option. So, where am I? Moon landings, yes. So I'm seeing flashing things in front of me on my screen. I just got distracted there for a second. Suddenly I saw my face pop up, and I don't know why my face popped up on my screen. It's a horrific sight. So also, everything we've been told about the Second World War, who are the instigators? Who are the bad guys? Everything we've been told is a lie. And when you start looking into it, you start to realize that Churchill played a far bigger role than most of us could have imagined in the aggressions and the crime and the unbelievable inhumane activity that was committed during the Second World War. Churchill seems to be the real villain and not necessarily the people that everyone has been pointing fingers at. Remember, history is written by the victors, and they can write the history books whichever way they choose to. And this is how it's been all along. And the victors, as you may know by now, are the global elite and the royal bloodlines that have been holding us hostage, enslaving us as humanity for so many thousands of years. But now we're waking up, And we're starting to understand this enslavement on so many levels. So it seems to me that if all the most recent events from the 9/11, from the moon landing, from the wars, the Second World War, the First World War, the Korean War, the Vietnam War, the Iraqi War, all these recent events, down to the Napoleonic Wars, to the ancient wars, what we actually know and don't know about Alexander the Great, how great he was for invading the world and killing and maiming and destroying people, how everything seems to be a false flag and manufactured and told by those who control the printing press, who control the media, who control the word of mouth of their time. And in ancient times, it was a certain group of people that controlled the knowledge and information that went out. And that knowledge and information was spread to the lands and to the people in the form and the way that they spread information in their day. In the 30s and the 40s, information was spread in a certain way through mostly radio. Then television came in, and suddenly television became the voice and the instrument of spreading information. Newspapers, obviously, since the turn of the century and before that already, newspapers were a main carrier of information and disinformation and a propaganda tool for those who control the printing press. So you realize that everything we've been told is a lie. Everything seems to have been stacked for thousands of years to keep eroding the truth and keep growing the lie, so much so that we don't even have the foggiest idea what the truth may be or how far away from the truth we are. Because the best way to tell a lie, as you may or may not know, is to stick as close to the truth but weave in some very shady information that then makes it very difficult to distinguish the truth from the lies. But sometimes the lies can be so big that we simply cannot believe that it's a lie. And that was the Goebbels propaganda machine. And just like the United States government propaganda machine is all about, the lies are so huge that people simply cannot believe it. I mean, 9/11, there's still people in the USA that believe that a bunch of Arabs hijacked some planes and flew them into the towers. It's insane. They do no research. They simply buy and swallow what they've been fed by the media. So now that we know that everything is a lie, it's quite possible that pretty much everything we've been told throughout our whole human history was a manufactured event to create a certain result, to have a certain result so they could then manipulate the people into doing certain things. And NASA are one of the biggest liars. The more you start studying NASA, you realize how they lie about pretty much everything. It is unbelievable. One of the greatest deceptions is that most of us believe that a picture of planet Earth has been taken from space. Well, to my horror, I realized quite recently that that is actually a lie. Not a single picture has ever been taken of planet Earth from space. This might come as a shock and horror to many people, but this is the absolute truth. It's called the Blue Marble, and the Blue Marble has gone through various stages. The first one taken in 1972, which is the most popular and the famous one, with Southern Africa, strangely enough, right at the center point. And the Blue Marble has taken on many shapes. And this is the guy that actually created the Blue Marble, a guy called Robert Simon. And he very proudly talks on his YouTube clips how he was given the task to create the perfect image of the ball Earth, of the planet, by using compilations of low Earth orbit images and compiling them together to create a complete image of what the Earth would look like from space. Okay? If you don't know this, please go and do your research, because now we're getting into the biggest lie of them all about NASA's space exploration and what's been going on right under our noses. And we're so dazzled and amazed by the lies because they're so big, we cannot imagine that somebody could possibly put together something so large and the lie that has been perpetuated on such a grand scale. So Blue Marble. Robert Simon, the creator of the image of our planet, which is a lie. This is one of the great examples that are often used. The difference between the blue marble in 2012 and then a year later in 2013, where you can see on the left the shape and size of the United States that takes up pretty much half of the world. And on the right-hand side, a year later, the United States has suddenly shrunk to be about half of the size it was a year before. Same, apparently, a picture from space. Right. If you believe that, you'll believe anything. And this is how NASA gets away with it. What I found fascinating, even when I watched the full 1.5 hours of the Apollo 11 1969 launch, what came to mind is the many thoughts I've had watching numerous launches of space shuttles and other rockets and other, you know, satellite rockets that apparently take satellites into space and so forth. You never ever see a rocket go straight up into the sky. Surely the shortest way from Earth into space is straight up into the sky, not on some weird trajectory. And even in the Apollo 1969 footage, what I found absolutely shocking is that within about 3 minutes of the launch, Apollo 11 is not flying up into the sky. It's flying horizontally, and it's about 102 miles high. In fact, Apollo 11 never went higher than 102 miles into that part of our atmosphere, or mesosphere, or stratosphere, whatever it is called at that altitude. And they've got all kinds of reasons and very complicated technical and mathematical formulas that they bring you, which is all lies and BS, just to confuse those that don't have enough knowledge and information. And most people don't have enough knowledge and information. And this is why we buy all their BS all the time. We just swallow it up. So what I found is that the trajectory of pretty much all the rockets and shuttles launched by NASA are very, very strange. They never go up. It's always this weird trajectory. And then within 3 minutes, let me tell you, of the launch of Apollo 11, within 3 minutes, the rocket was too far to be picked up by cameras. So what they then do, they switch to animation mode, and the rest of the world watch the entire Apollo mission and the moon landing in animation mode. That was the original Apollo moon landing. We watched a bloody animation of the event. And then they switch over to Pinewood Studios in England, where all the scenes on the moon were shot by Stanley Kubrick, and this is what was broadcast to us. That is how big the lie is. The entire moon landing thing has been a ongoing lie. Obviously, we don't mention the Van Allen belts, which are deadly radiation belts that start at about 1,000 miles high and go to, I think, about 3,000 or 6,000 miles. Radiation belts that go around planet Earth that no one or no thing can go through. It's like going through a lethal giant microwave. It'll fry you in seconds. And yet in 1969, three guys in a little tin can went to the moon through the Van Allen belts and returned safely to look very happy, like they've just been down, you know, from LA to New York and back, and say, well, what a great trip we had. It's all lies. So this brings us to where this whole thing of our ball Earth, NASA has been showing us the blue marble, where that all started. And it's fascinating because it actually only started in 1543 with this guy called Copernicus. Prior to that, pretty much all ancient cultures believed that the Earth was flat. They all speak about a flat Earth. Even the ancient Greek philosophers talk about flat Earths. And this is really important stuff to digest, people. Copernicus is a well-known Freemason. Now I'm going into some deep conspiracy in some people's minds and opinions, but this is not conspiracy. This is just simply facts and information. You can call it what you want. Copernicus was the instigator that was used by the elite to propose this new heliocentric model where the sun is at the center. Prior to this, Everybody believed for millennia and millennia that the sun moved around the earth. The sun and the moon moved around the earth and not the earth moving around the sun. Copernicus changed all that. Obviously, the Catholic Church was not happy with that. Isn't it interesting that the Catholic Church in those days was not happy with that? And yet today, they're promoting a whole new ball earth philosophy. Then about 60 years later, comes along this guy called Galileo Galilei, who takes this thing to a whole nother level. He makes this little puny little telescope that is a lot weaker than most of the powerful binoculars today, or camera lenses that can give you, 60 times magnification and 100 times magnification. And Galileo Galilei miraculously sees the moons of Jupiter with his little telescope that magnifies only 30 times. And suddenly the whole heliocentric and a ball earth philosophy gets even more entrenched. And there it is. In fact, when you start doing a research, you find very little evidence, and I watched some interesting documentaries on this, that the earth is actually moving. And this was a shock to me, I must tell you. This was an absolute shock to me when very recently I watched a documentary. In fact, I posted it on my Facebook page because it blew my mind so much, where all the most current recent scientists from all the universities, from Mika Koku, who you often see, all claiming that there is no real scientific evidence that the earth is moving through space. Do with that information what you want. I'm going to carry on here. Then around 1680, this guy comes along, Isaac Newton, and suddenly, we all know he was a very advanced Freemason as well. It's very important to keep tabs on this, people. All these instigators of new ideas and thoughts throughout pretty much all of human history are all renowned Freemasons, especially in the last 1,000 years. Okay. Or especially in the last 500 years, should I say. So Isaac Newton comes along and suddenly he brings this idea of gravity to us. And remember that this is an observation that he made, and suddenly gravity becomes a new force, something that we observe but we cannot explain. And it seems that it was all perfectly stacked new ideas to promote a whole new concept of a ball earth, where previously nobody cared about gravity because everybody knew the earth was flat. So suddenly you start seeing the evolution of the idea and the thought. And if you're new to this, keep your mind open, because I'm going to share some interesting things with you that are very easily explained. So gravity is this something that we observe, and when you ask any scientist or any astronomer, any mathematician, any physicist today to explain what gravity is and how it works, it cannot be explained. This was another thing that really blows your mind when you realize how little we know about something that we just take for granted and believe someone that wrote a whole bunch of rules and laws about this thing called gravity, this new force. Well, you'll find that all the things that we've covered, sound and resonance that give rise to magnetism, moving magnetic fields that give rise to electricity, and the manifestation of all matter and all everything in creation out of sound and resonance, and therefore everything has a magnetic capacity to it, because everything comes out of sound and resonance, and sound and resonance creates magnetic fields. Therefore, it is a lot easier to explain gravity, what gravity actually is with the understanding of sound and magnetism. Remember that your heart has its own electromagnetic field around it. The way that the blood moves through our veins creates, it makes a sound, And that sound that the blood makes as it moves through your veins, as it spirals through your veins, that sound creates a magnetic field and an electromagnetic field in our body that extends beyond our body. And then you've got to ask yourself, what makes your heart beat? You know, and when you go to medical school, or what I studied, pharmaceutics, they teach you all this nonsensical garbage as to why your heart beats. It's all these nonsensical ideas that actually have no scientific backup. Your heart beats because it's connected to the primordial source frequency, the source code, the sound of creation. That's what makes your heart beat. And that same sound that makes your heart beat creates electromagnetic fields around our bodies. And now we start to understand what gravity most likely is. It's another magnetic effect. Sound manifests matter, creates magnetic fields that create electricity and the electromagnetic universe. Everything is affected by sound and magnetism, sound and resonance and magnetism or magnetic fields. And especially us, we are connected to everything. Our hearts are connected to the source code, the sound frequency of the creator, the sound frequency of creation itself that make our hearts beat, that create the gravity, that create the sound and magnetism through our hearts, the electromagnetic field around us. And therefore, it is a lot easier to say that gravity is a consequence of sound and magnetism and the magnetoelectric universe and not the electromagnetic universe, as it's often called. So it is just getting more and more exciting for us to get into the heart of this information. And at this note, we have to throw the elephant into the room. And the most exciting debate that I've ever come across that has emerged over the last 2 to 3 years and has exploded around the world. And many people just do not want to go there. But we have to keep our minds open and discuss this. The flat earth versus the ball earth versus the flat earth, vice versa. So remember, everything we've been told is a lie. Throughout ancient times, we've been exposed to lies and deceptions hidden in plain sight, in ancient carvings, in ancient murals, in ancient pictures. The walls, the ceilings, and the floors of ancient churches and temples are filled with advanced knowledge of sound, resonance, magnetism, and beyond. Hollywood has taken that role on today to expose the truths to us and hide it in plain sight. Many of you know this already. This is not news to anyone. Some of the best examples, as you know, are the movie The Matrix, that we are actually in a matrix. We have measured that. We have measured, Paul Cravenstein and many others have measured the energy fields around the earth or up in the sky, should we say. Let's not say around the earth. Let's say the energy fields up in the sky, because we always look up at the sky. And obviously the Wizard of Oz, the Wizard of Gold, follow the yellow brick road that leads to the Wizard of Oz, the Wizard of Gold. He who controls the gold controls the world. And so they explain and expose this knowledge and information to us, always hidden in plain sight. And this is what I find absolutely fascinating. The Truman Show is another one of those hidden in plain sight. The whole TV show was broadcast from the world's largest stage, film stage ever constructed, this giant dome, that this make-believe reality and this make-believe life of an entire town in the Truman Show was broadcast to the outside world. And sooner or later, Truman discovered that he was in a show, that he was not free, that he was under a dome, and that there was a way out. I find it fascinating that in recent times, we have a book by Stephen King that's called Under the Dome. And that book was then turned into a TV show. What's fascinating, by the way, if you look at that picture under the dome, look at that picture right sort of at the top, and you see some interesting patterns forming there. It looks like water or light shimmering on the surface of water, right? And this is Under the Dome, the TV show, the TV series. And this brings us to the maps of the world of ancient cultures. And we realize that ancient scripture in pretty much all ancient civilizations talk about this flat earth and this firmament in the sky that was created by God or the creator. It talks about how God creates the heavens and the earth and how God then puts the firmament in the sky to separate the waters of the heavens from the waters of the earth. And the more you read the scriptures, I must add, the more this reality becomes more and more real. How we completely misunderstood the scriptures and how we've been manipulated into believing something that may not be so. This is a spectacular example of the firmament in the sky, and you see the stars, the moon, and the sun is inside the firmament. And there's a guy at the bottom sticking his head out of the firmament, looking out what's beyond the firmament. And that remains the interesting question, because we know that there's this energetic grid up in the sky. We've discussed this. We've measured it. We know it's there. So what is outside that energy grid? And here's this guy, the bottom left, looking out of this firmament or the energy grid in the sky that even the Anunnaki talk about, or the Sumerian clay tablets talk about. And he's looking up at outside our reality. And what he sees remains an interesting discussion. I'm not going to go there right now, but that really looks interesting. And you could almost, if you start reading Ezekiel, the images there might resemble something like Ezekiel describes in the Bible. And so let's look at some of the other ancient civilizations and how they depict the sky and the earth. And this is the Inca world, the Inca planet, flat earth and the firmament around it. Here we have the Mayan firmament above the sky with the sun and the moon and the stars and the flat earth underneath it. And notice that the flat earth doesn't stop where the earth is. It actually goes and continues as a spherical form, a spherical shape underneath. And here we have a Navajo Indian firmament and the shape of the world. Again, from this dome, the firmament above the sky, to and going underneath. And we suddenly realize that that this, on the left here, we have an ancient Hebrew understanding of the world and our reality and the waters above the firmament, waters of the heavens, and the sun and the moon being inside the firmament, and then the earth and what's underneath the earth and the great deep, all one giant big sphere. And suddenly we realize that this model of a flat earth in the center with a firmament at the top and the continuation of the spherical sphere underneath is very similar to the images on the right, as you can see, of the double torus that brings energy from the top and the bottom and then expels the matter and energy at the equator, right? And suddenly we have a much better understanding how it is possible that the earth could actually in fact be flat on the surface because of the sound resonance and the magnetic fields and even the electron model that I showed earlier, the electron model that I should put in here, that actually shows us exactly this kind of manifestation of energy and matter at the equator. And I'm not going to go into this. This is going to be for another presentation. What's fascinating even more is the fact that the United Nations map actually shows the flat earth map the same way as being promoted by the flat earth movement and those doing the research in that area. But even more fascinating that in January 1907, on the front page of the Hawaiian Gazette, and I think also in the Honolulu News, they featured this ancient map that was found in Tibet and then brought to Honolulu or brought to Hawaii. And they published this map of an ancient world showing the flat earth map. And outside the Antarctic wall, which is outside of the flat earth map, we see dozens of giant pieces of land. So this really poses a question. What's going on here? Who is lying and who's telling the truth here? Admiral Richard E. Byrd became one of United States' most celebrated explorers. And in an interview in 1953, I believe, he clearly talks. He was called the most famous explorer in American history. He was one of the few people, if not the only one, that crossed the North Pole and led an expedition. He was also a promoter of the whole Hollow Earth or Agartha principle. He actually claims that he somehow entered another world, another realm. It seems to be inside the earth, which he couldn't explain. And then Admiral Byrd also did a major Antarctica expedition with planes and ships and a huge team of people. He had several expeditions to Antarctica, which you can go and do your own research. And then in 1953, I believe it was 1953, that he did this interview on one of the major television networks in the USA, where he very openly states that on the other side of Antarctica, now I'm not sure how you get to the other side of Antarctica, but on the other side of Antarctica, there are vast unexplored lands never seen by any human that are much larger than the United States. These are his words. You can go and watch his entire interview on YouTube that was recently released. Admiral Byrd, one of the most celebrated explorers in the United States history. And that really tells us that there's stuff going on beyond Antarctica that we don't know. And this is why Antarctica is a no-go zone. And the Antarctic Treaty was signed by all the major countries in the world. No one can own it. Nothing can happen there. And a number of countries have stations there that do apparently experiments and research in Antarctica. But before we finish this debate on the flat Earth or the ball Earth, I went into this about 2 years ago. It came to my attention. I ignored it for the first year, just like most people do. I just thought this whole flat Earth movement was a bunch of nonsense by a bunch of ignorant people that are just trying to distract us from reality and what's going on. Just another distraction. And I thought there was possibly an infiltration by the elite to just confuse us. And then a year later, I started looking at it more seriously, and I thought, let me explore what these guys are saying. Let me see if there's any merit to what they say. So I was looking for some undeniable, irrefutable scientific facts that I could hook myself into. And I found that in the very simple realization that there is no curvature. And this simply blew my mind. So I urge you, those that are really struggling with this flat Earth thing, the ball Earth versus the flat Earth, go out there, do some research, and look at the curvature issue. This is the most important scientific, irrefutable fact that will hopefully launch you on a more detailed journey of research. And this is a view from Michigan City to Chicago across Lake Michigan. That view across there, I believe, is about 40 miles. Well, 40 miles across the lake, Chicago should be completely invisible. If you use the mathematical formula to calculate the curvature of the Earth, the curvature of the so-called horizon beyond which ships disappear on the ocean, which is absolute nonsense, and you'll see why when you start to research this, we should not be able to see Chicago at all. Maybe the top of that tallest tower will possibly be seen, because from 40 miles away, Chicago should be about 1,060 feet below the horizon based on the curvature. The formula to calculate the curvature of the Earth, of the horizon, is 8 times distance in miles squared. Okay, if you don't know this, remember this. If you do research, you'll find it very quickly. 8 times distance in miles squared. So this is 40 miles. So 40 times 40 is 1,600. So it'll be 8 times 1,600, and you get the answer in inches. Do those numbers, and you'll see it's impossible to see Chicago from Michigan City if the Earth was a ball, and therefore there is no curvature. No curvature from any height. As you know, I've done a lot of flying around the world, and no matter what height you are in an aeroplane, the horizon always rises up to meet you. At halfway down, halfway up in the sky, the horizon is always at eye level. And there is simply no curvature. I do this every time I fly. I pick up one of these, one of the menus or something in the pocket in front of you, and I put it up against the window, and you can see it's as flat as possible. Here is another example. This Dingyang Bridge in China. It's 102 miles long. In 102 miles, there should be curvature of 6,900 feet. So from the one side to the other, you should not even be able to see the other side, and yet you do very, very clearly. The more you go and do your research, the more you realize that you can see across vast, flat water space and see people walking on the beach where you should not be able to see them. So the only conclusion we can reach is the fact that you can see that there is no curvature. Here's one of the greatest researchers of our time, Auguste Piccard. Very few people know about him until you start doing this research and you realize that the commander of the spaceship Enterprise in Star Trek is called Auguste Piccard, after this particular explorer, French explorer in 1931. That went up into space in his hot air balloon. He still holds the world record of going highest in his hot air balloon. I believe he went up something like 15 miles, or was it 16 kilometers high, or 56 kilometers. Sorry, I speak under correction now. And when he came back, they thought he got lost in space. And when he came back after 48 hours or so, obviously, he became a highly celebrated individual. And in his description that was printed in Popular Science in 1931, he states very clearly that from up there, the Earth seemed a flat disc with upturned edges. No talk of any curvature. Well, we have the physical evidence, the photographs. There is no curvature. And we're getting to the end of this presentation, which I've really enjoyed putting together, because it brought into connectedness all the areas of knowledge of information from science, from history, religion, ancient civilizations, tools and artifacts, cone-shaped tools, resonance, everything, including the flat Earth and the lies and deceptions of NASA. The fact that there is no curvature, people, and there is no curvature, please go and do this research for yourself. That means only one thing, that we cannot be living on a ball Earth. That's the only conclusion we can reach. So that is now the conclusion that I've reached, because I have found no curvature. The scientists of today very clearly tell us that there is no real scientific evidence, just conjecture and suggestions. No scientific evidence that the Earth is actually moving through space. There's a lot more to this, a lot more. But once you open this door, just like any other door that opens the door to the rabbit hole, you will find information that'll blow your mind. It will shake the foundations of everything you've been told, because it truly is the biggest lie we've been told, is the cover-up of the shape of the world we live on. And I believe that our understanding of sound and magnetic fields, as I've showed you, and how the torus shapes and the torus effect actually works, of sound, matter, and magnetic effects, how that actually promotes the existence of a flat earth, of a flat piece of matter, of soil, of earth with water on it, that is surrounded by an energetic field above and below, The sound, resonance, and the toroidal shape studies suggest that far more seriously than anything else. I hope this has given you some thought and insight, is that the flat earth thing is not just some crazy idea, some crazy people that want to distract us, but the fact that it actually affects everything. Our religion, our history, our science, our physics, our astronomy, our cosmology, and it now becomes the biggest lie that we've been told. So this brings us to the end of this presentation. It was more than 2 hours. It was 2.5 hours. I want to thank you for hanging around and for apologizing for yesterday when we couldn't do this because of the power failure. The technology and the energy, the free energy, let us down. And I look forward to exploring this more, connecting more of these dots, and sharing more information. I have a lot more where this comes from, a lot more information, a lot more ideas, and as I say, the dots that are connecting. And I believe that our exploration of the stone circles of Southern Africa and what we find and measuring the energies are going to give us a lot more knowledge and a lot more understanding of what's really going on here. So I hope you enjoy this and have a beautiful day or a beautiful night, all depending where you are. And I'll catch you again very soon. I want to remind you that I'll be going to Brazil the first 2 weeks of December to have meetings with the Ubuntu team there and meeting with several mayors that have already embraced the Ubuntu philosophy and our plan for one small town that already want to implement this in Brazil. So I'll be meeting with at least one mayor and probably another 20 or 30 mayors that want to embrace and implement our one small town philosophy that will change the world. So until later and further and the next time, have a good day and a good night.